Hello everybody, I just finished building this DIY battery and the capacity test worked out awesome. Stick around if you want to see exactly how I built it and the test. Hi, I'm David and welcome to my channel where I like to build projects that are DIY, renewable energy, and energy efficiency. For this build, we are going to use this empty battery box, which has the same dimensions as some of the popular brands that you could purchase. It is a very nice form factor. Now, it's a completely empty box right now, and we're going to fill it using some of these lithium iron phosphate cells. Now, these are brand new cells from Battery Hookup, and these are 3.2 volt nominal because they're lithium iron phosphate. At the end of the project, we'll do a capacity test and we'll run through all the numbers and see what it comes out to in the end for cost. Hopefully, we can build it less expensive, more affordably than what you could buy it for off the shelf, and it should be a lot more fun to build it ourselves. So here we go. All right, everybody, let's take a closer look at these cells we're going to be using. These are brand new cells from Battery Hookup, 3.2 volts nominal and 5,000 milliamp hour. And they were manufactured just a few months ago. And if we put these next to each other, we can see the new lithium iron phosphate battery is actually slightly taller, which I was surprised by because this says 65 on it, and this is also a 65. 18, and this is 32. But this one did turn out to be longer, so it might be more like a 32 by 700, 65 millimeters. So that's right on the dot with the 7 centimeters, which is going to be 70 millimeters. So I actually wish that they labeled this as a 32 700. Plan fitting these into something really tight, and that might make a difference to you, the 5 millimeters. All right, let's put this away. We're left with about an inch or 3 centimeters of extra space. So as far as how many of these cells can we fit in here, I bought a bunch of these 2 cell holders and 3 cell holders, and they'll fit in this orientation. So we have 4 across the bottom and 5 tall. So we have a little bit of play, but not enough to go with the 5 wide. So this works out fine. We're going to get a 20P or 20 cells in parallel and 4S. Since these are 5,000 milliamp hour cells, according to that number right there, this will turn out to be exactly a 100 amp hour pack. Now there is a little bit of space right here. The lid is taller than the top of this lip, and that extra height will help when we add the BMS. Now the cells and the cell holders I purchased from Battery Hookup, and this case I bought from AliExpress, and I'll leave links to everything in the description below. If you're going to purchase anything from Battery Hookup, you can use the coupon code DavidPaws, and that will get you 10% off. So we're going to take 4 of these cells and put them in series, which is going to create a 12.8 volt nominal pack, which will work really well. It's going to have a good voltage range for typical 12 volt applications. Well, all 8 cell holders are now done. I noticed one little quirk. Where I have the 2 cell holder joining in, it caused this little oddball where some of the dovetails pop out on the wrong side, just on where I have the 3 and the 2 lined up with each other. Now, it won't cause any functional difference, but that could have been eliminated, let's say, if I just got all 3 cell holders only and then cut off the last of the 3 cells. I ordered a case of 100 of these cells because I wasn't sure exactly how many I could fit in here. It turns out 80 can fit in very nicely with room to spare for the BMS. So you can order just as many as you want. You don't have to order a case of 100. Now, something to note, the box did get a little damaged in shipping, which is a little disappointed right here. You know, I wish that wasn't the case, but when I opened it up, the cell itself doesn't look like it has any damage. It doesn't look like it has any dents, but still, I'm not going to use the cells in the 4 corners. And with all the cells in one of the trays, we'll take the next one and put it on here and give it a little, it went in pretty easily. Sometimes you have to shake it a little bit to get the cells to fit in. The covers could come off and they could fall apart if I'm not careful. So I'm gonna hang this over the edge just a little bit, and I've got some of this Kapton tape, and this is a high temperature tape. Before I spot weld these, which will parallel the cells, I want to double check that all the cells are within 1/10 of a volt of each other. 3.29, 3.28. Terrific. Every single cell is between 3.2 and 3.3, so we're within a tenth. I didn't see anything below 3.24. and I didn't see anything above 3.29. Yesterday, I was spending quite a bit of time mocking up different scenarios. I've got different types of nickel strips, different thicknesses. Here's a coil of some nickel-plated copper strip. So I've been mocking up different scenarios and trying to come up with the best solution of how I can do this. When you plan your series connection, there's several things that need to come into play. Part of it is how this all folds together or gets into the enclosure. How are we going to actually make those connections? But also, how many amps are we going to be carrying? This cell group has 20 cells in it. This can easily do 100 amps. And this BMS that I have is a 100 amp BMS. But in reality, you don't want to charge these over 50 amps, which would be a half C rate. And that's because when you start charging a cell more than a half C rate, you're going to start causing excess heat to build up. And when these are packed together in a small enclosure, that can start to become a problem. Now, not necessarily, but potentially. And this is why you find even other companies like Battleborne Battery, the KiloVault, the Victron Energy, when they have these modules that are already built as a 100 amp hour lithium iron phosphate, they recommend in the user manual not to go beyond a half C, not to go more than a 50 amp charge. And that's because of the heat buildup. Now, when you take all these factors into account, I have decided to limit the amp capacity of this pack to 50 amps. So I have here a Midnight Solar brand circuit breaker of 50 amps. So that is going to be the weakest link. Now, I want to make sure that all of my series connections are capable of 50 amps continuous without overheating. Now, for example, this nickel strip is 0.15 millimeter by 8 millimeter. This is good for about 5 amps. Now, this is a double wide nickel strip made for 32 millimeter cells, which is what we have here. Now, if you look at just this part of it, just one stretch, now this is about, 15 millimeter by 0.2 millimeter. So this is good for 12 amps. So if I use 5 of these strips, that is a 60 amp capacity continuous. And I know that the series connections won't be the limiting factor. I won't overheat them. Now, I've mocked up how I'm gonna fold these accordion style here, just with tape. Right here in the middle, we have put down some nickel strip and it's not yet spot welded. And I just put a piece of Kapton tape to hold it in place and a straight edge to make sure that we're lined up. So I have a temperature sensor here and it's just jammed into this XT90 connector. And I wanna stop when we start overheating. We're gonna change the joules and we're gonna go to 50 joules. Now 50 joules is about right for 0.2 millimeter nickel. That's what we're using here. So we're at 50 joules. Now we press this once. We're gonna go down to calibrate. We're gonna hit calibrate. It's gonna tell me open. I click to say, yep, I'm open. Now it says to short. So literally you're gonna hold these two probes really tight together and press and hold. You saw the wires jump because it actually sent some electricity through there. And then we can release when it said okay. Now I'm gonna press this again. I'm gonna go up to mode, enter, and auto. If you can hear that clicking now, so we just finished that row and they all look good.
50 joules. Let's see what our temperature is. Whoa, 84.4 degrees Celsius. And that probe is right there in that XT connector. If I take off a glove and check, yeah, that is hot. So I'm going to take the tape off and reposition this. And that will give the XT90 a chance to cool off a little bit. See, it drops pretty quick, but that's a lot for it. 50 joules. It's not as big of a deal when you're using thin material because you can turn down the power setting.
Now that this is finished being spot welded and I put a layer of Kapton tape on it, I want one more layer because these are going to fold in and touch each other. Now this is some paper with adhesive on one side, and I did a search for battery paper and this is what came up. I think I've heard somebody call it barley paper before. It kind of feels like a thick construction paper. Adhesive on one side, peel off the backer. Now I'm going to stick this on the negative battery, right down the seam. This is the exciting part. Turning it up. Bend this in. Yep, so I think that will work well. Here, you can see the nickel right there, and I'm just kind of pressing these two sides together to make sure that nickel has a good crease on it right at the intersection. Nice, there we go. Here's the positive side. I set this up yesterday where I oriented all the nickel strips on a piece of plywood. I then soldered them to four layers of copper strips so that I could get the amp carrying capacity that I want. And then I just soldered on a pair of 10 gauge wires. Now I used a pair of 10 gauge because that's the same gauge wires that the BMS has. Still have some more spot welds to do up here, but I have to wait till the spot welder cools down. And these positive wires are going to come off and come up the side, and I still have to do the negative on that one. Okay, all the spot welds are done up top, so now let's fold this over. This is the wiring harness for the BMS. Now the main positive wire is this red one. It needs to go over here onto this positive bus bar. And then each one needs to tie in subsequently. Now I'm letting the, usually I'd want to put this on first, but I'm letting the spot welder cool down right now. So I'm going to go ahead and solder these on while I can, and then we'll spot weld the last main bus bar later. Okay, so if I open this up, then I can see right here is some. So let's go ahead and try to solder to that. All right, so this worked out fine. Now I'm sorry, I just couldn't get a good camera angle to show you while I did it. But I just peeled back a little bit of tape and put that on there. I'm gonna tape this over again. Now, there's a little recess in the plastic. See, there's a high point in the plastic here and here. And there's a recess, that's where the wire is coming out. Okay, so I put a little tape on there and now I'll close this back up. And you can see there's plenty of space that it's not gonna short out to the next cell. Like it's not gonna rub by doing that. So that's in place, this one's in place. Next, I'll go right here to that one because it's nice and convenient. So I'm gonna take the plug and the first two wires are done. So I'm gonna grab the third wire and now run my fingers along it so that I don't screw that up. And this is the one that's gonna be soldered on here. This is a little bit of flux. So the first thing is just to get a little bit of solder on there. There we go.
All right, so now we've got the, now we have the BMS, and it comes over here, and I want to attach it right at this point. Okay, so what I did is I just took a little strip of nickel and I jumped it over these two wires and spot welded it. And that will help keep them down and in place. Getting some solder in from the backside. So now we have the BMS attached to this, which I pre-made in the right orientation. All these nickel strips need to be spot welded up here onto the battery, but I'll go ahead and solder on the last wire for the BMS voltage sense, which is this black one. So that soldered on fine. There we go. All right, so now I've got all the voltage sense wires. I'm not yet done. I still have more spot welds to do, but this is overheating, so I'm going to let it cool. Over here, we have the voltage sense wires. So what I like to do before ever plugging this into the BMS, we need to make sure that I haven't crossed a wire. I haven't jumped one in the wrong location. So to do that, let's take a multimeter and we'll set it to volts DC, 3.2. You have to be careful not to touch your two probes of the multimeter. Now this should go up by another 3.2, and it did. Another 3.2, yes, and the last and final 13, perfect. It's easy to keep track of the wires when it's only a 4S, but when I'm doing my big 14S or 16S battery packs, this you can sometimes cross these. So, but we've got them all in the correct location. Now if you do cross them and you plug it into the BMS, you will likely blow out the BMS. You'll burn out one of those little chips on it.
Now I've taped this top end and we have the BMS attached, which is back here. So let's go ahead and put a little bit more paper on this assembly. All right, well, this is looking really good now. It's a solid package. Okay, there we go.
I have to put spacers in so that the wires on this side don't get crushed. And then over here, and probably over on this side too, I'll just add some block or something. So I want to use this half inch cutting board as a spacer on this side, and I want to prevent then all these wires and stuff from hitting the side of the box. So I'm going to route out this part right here for this cable. Now probably if I did it again, I should have just put the positive wires up here, but my thought was, you know, diagonally, because that helps even out the flow, but I don't know, probably not necessary. Anyways, let me route this out. All right, I routed out the board and I'm gonna put it on here like this. I need to cut this tape because the tape's in my way. So, as much as I like having that tape, right down in here you can kind of see getting it in. So I'm just reaching in with my finger and pushing it into that groove. And then I can push it against there. And now I'm going to tape this in place.
I have half inch cutting board on each end. I also have a piece of half inch cutting board down here, and it's routed out for that positive wire. All right, let's tip it upright. I think that's gonna work. And yeah, that should work. Uh-oh, sticking a little bit. Okay. Snug fit. All right, when I plug this in, I'm gonna put a Bluetooth dongle on here. Now, this may or may not work with Android, but I'm gonna try it. Now, this Bluetooth dongle is a separate part that you can purchase. It doesn't come with the BMS. I was able to download the app from Battery Hookup's website, open the app on my phone, and I was able to discover the BMS, but I couldn't actually get the BMS to open inside the app. Instead, an error message was coming up on the screen saying that it doesn't work with the version of Android that I have on this phone. This is a Google Pixel 3, so whatever version comes with that. Now, this is my wife's Apple phone, and it looks like it has discovered the BMS. So let's go ahead and see if we can get information from the BMS. It says waiting for data, and it looks like it opened. Hey, that's great. So here's the BMS, Bluetooth dongle. We have a blue light, and it looks like it has connected to the Apple. So in this case, we're looking at 21%, 13.13. That's great. Well, let's see what the settings are from the factory. Let's see here, if we hit configure. Writing parameters to BMS costs more money? I guess the free version of the app will let you look at the cells, look at maybe the watts coming in and out, it says power there, but it won't let me set the parameters. So what voltage to overcharge, what voltage to balance, those types of things. We have the circuit breaker rated for 150 volts DC and 50 amps. And I'm gonna get it as close to this positive terminal as possible so that the rest of this room won't interfere with the BMS. So if I put it up like this, you'll see I'll just be flipping the lid on here, and I want the circuit breaker and the BMS to be on different sides so they don't interfere. I start by cutting this close inside, because I can always go wider. You see, I need two holes for the two screws. It's gonna be a little bit offset, but I think it'll go in like this. I'm not sure yet if they're gonna reach. They're fairly short, but let's give it a shot. All right, so here's the screw, and I use this thread checker, and I found that it's a 6x32, a 5/16 right now. Let's see if we can get one a half inch. Going through my pile of random screws, I was able to find a couple of 6x32s, but these are too long. So let's go ahead and put them in, and then we'll measure how much we have to cut off. So now we have the circuit breaker in place, and if I flip this over, we can see how much the screws protrude out. Now I have the screws bottomed out inside the circuit breaker, so now I can measure this distance, and that's how much we have to cut off. And it looks like we have to cut off 3/10 of an inch. If I cut these off just using a hacksaw, that would leave a rough edge that would then have to be cleaned up. So instead, there's an easier way to cut these off. This is just a pair of wire strippers. It's just a generic one that I've had for as long as I can remember. But it has 6/32 printed right there. So what you can do is open it up, and we'll screw this into the 6/32 hole. And there's threads on this upper piece of metal, and then the bottom hole is just open. So it will scissor that off. It'll just snip it off for us. You can see it coming through there. Now if I apply pressure, it's gonna cut it off, but I haven't measured it yet. So we know that we wanna cut off 3/10 of an inch. So we'll come over here to the back side. Now remember, it's gonna cut it off right in the middle between the two. So we'll go like this. Now that would cut off too much. So I'll back it out a little bit.
So now I'll just squeeze this like that. There's the piece that came off, and we'll unscrew this. And as we, I'll have to unscrew it using a screwdriver, because that'll come out of the, there we go. So that should thread in okay. Now that those screws are shorter, we were able to screw the circuit breaker in place. I mocked up what I needed with this piece of nickel, and now I am putting it on this scrap piece of copper that I have. Now drill out these holes, and what this is going to wind up doing is making the connection between the circuit breaker. It's going to go on like that and then fold down and go onto there. Let's see if this double layer can fit on here. Yep, fits over that stud. Looks like that's off a little bit. I just think it's the bend. Let me try to rebend it. Now one layer could probably handle the amps no problem. Serrated flanged bolt, thread locker. There we go. It's on the circuit breaker. Great. Okay, both of these are torqued down nice and tight. I threw down some paper in between the battery cells and the BMS, just one more layer of protection. I marked here the distance that this edge of the plastic comes out so that they won't interfere. And I'm gonna tape down this BMS and kind of get it right up like that, real close to this edge so that I have enough space for the slack of this wire. All I need on this edge is enough space for the lip of the lid. There's two layers of the lid here. So this can get real close up to that side. The temperature sensor's under there. The voltage wires come over here. So let's get this taped down. So the next thing to do, we're gonna cut this off. We're gonna put some ring terminals on here with the hydraulic crimper. That's gonna be on both sides. And then we'll finally be able to attach it to the lid section.
Now each one of these wires is a fine strand 10 gauge wire with silicone insulation, so it's high temperature insulation. They're nice wires. I think I can fit them into an 8 gauge ring terminal. So I have some 8 gauge ring terminals here.
There we are, nice. So both wires can get in there at the same time. Now we can crimp that. I'm gonna try a number 10 die. We'll see if it works. Pull on each wire individually, and I'm not getting any movement, so we're good. There we go. Okay. Now these three have Loctite on them. I threw on just a little bit of electrical tape over those terminals. So now we have plenty of slack in there. Now we just have to crimp on the ring terminal for this one. This is the ring terminal that I had, and I drilled it out to accept the larger bolt for the brass terminal. Now I'm not happy with that, so I'm not gonna put any Loctite on it. I've already gone online and ordered a new crimp ring for this. So I'll fix this as soon as it comes in, but I want to finish testing this battery and get the video out for you guys. And no Loctite because I'm going to replace this ring terminal. That red wire there, I have to miss the BMS, so I'm just going to reach in with my fingers and pull it to the side a little bit. And we should be okay. I'm just gonna put a layer of electrical tape
on here right now because I have to get in here in a few days when the new ring terminals arrive. Well, the battery is complete, but we still need to test it. So give me a minute and I will clear the workbench because I have 4 days worth of tools piled up on here. It has taken me 4 days to build this. Probably will take you guys a lot less if you do it yourselves because you won't have the camera and the lighting and trying to get all that. So I have these wire leads that I've built previously. I have a whole collection of different adapter wires that I've had to build for different projects. This one here is ring terminals on 10 gauge wire to an XT60 connection.
Circuit breakers on. So this is now charging.
This is about 100 watts. So I put this to 6.5 amps just because I wanted to see the balancing function. And we had two for a second there and then one shut off. Let's see if we can get the cells any closer. Right now we're 43 millivolts. So it looks like it stopped before the cells actually reached 100%. It says over voltage protection. It looks like cell group number two must have went over, and it's not balancing right now. The BMS turned it off, but I wasn't sure about being absolutely 100%, so I turned it on again just at 1 amp. That's the, I programmed this to 1 amp, and the purpose there is to allow for the balancing to take place. It looks like cell group number two is a little bit higher in voltage, so it's balancing out, but it probably, the BMS shut it off probably before we actually hit 100% because this probably went into over voltage protection. So the more times that I cycle the battery, the more chances this will get to balance. Now it looks like it's not balancing when it's just in storage mode. It's only balancing while charging. So it will eventually allow for more capacity. But if I was to do a capacity test right now, it would be a little bit low. So I'll probably cycle this a few times and then try to do a capacity test for camera. So that cell group two is definitely at a higher state of charge than the other three cell groups. And right there we hit over voltage. And it shut off, and I heard this beep and shut off, but the BMS internally is what shut it off. This guy didn't hit pack voltage, so that's a good thing that the BMS is working when you hit over voltage. So the BMS is doing its job, and the more times I cycle this, the more this can bring it back together. I've had this inverter for a long time. I just use it in my car if I need something, but otherwise I don't have a lot of 12 volt stuff. I prefer the bigger inverters. So here's the shunt for the meter. And so we'll go ahead and turn this on. Now this is a 300 watt inverter. And I think this was a 250 watt heater. And we'll do a little bit of a load and then we'll try to charge it up again a little bit more. Okay, so the heater did kick on. We're over 300 watts on the DC side. That might cause this to overheat. We'll see. I've never actually done a capacity test on this inverter to see where it actually overloads. It shows 21.46 amps, 21.2 amps. So they are close. This is showing 286 watts and 281 watts. So if anything, this is reading a little bit lower. And as you can see, the cell differential dropped really close to each other as soon as you put a load on it, because this is in that plateau of the voltage curve. If you're not sure what I'm talking about, these are lithium iron phosphate cells, and they have a voltage curve that is very steep in the beginning, plateaus, and then falls off really steep at the end. So when you're in this middle range here, between about 3 volts and 3.4 volts, it's all plateau, and you only see it go really high up, right at the very top end and very bottom end,
which is why we typically recommend you either top balance or bottom balance. Now, I did not top balance or bottom balance these cells or the cell groups specifically because I wanted to see this BMS do its balance function. I mean, sorry, I'm holding the cell phone. Cell phone is just my monitor with the app for the BMS, but I wanted to actually see it do its balancing. I wanted to make sure that occurred, and it does. If I had top balanced these cell groups, the BMS would not have seen a differential, and it wouldn't have done any balancing, and I could not have verified then whether or not that worked. We haven't started balancing yet, so that means that the differential is not large enough. Yeah, so it's at 15 millivolts that it starts balancing. You can see it jumping between 14 and 15 millivolts. As soon as it hits 15, it begins balancing. Now the balancing is just little tiny resistors that are built into this thing. We are almost ready to overvoltage here. 3.65, there we go. And it did it. So the BMS shut off, and that means that beeped. So fantastic, we caught it on camera. All right, we're ready to begin the discharge capacity test. So let me turn this off here, and I'll just unplug this so we don't have anything else going on that side. Over here on the meter, we have an extra 17 watt hours, so we want to get rid of that. There we go, zero. Turn on the inverter, turn on the heater. Now we're going to ramp up. Okay, great. Let's check what time it is. 11:16. We're discharging. Excellent. So we'll let this run and we'll see what our capacity is. So this will take 4 or 5 hours to discharge, and then we'll be able to come back and find out what our capacity is. At this point, we're probably around 2 hours into the test. Everything is still running. So this is showing that we've used 40 amp hours. Let's see. Boom. We're still rocking and rolling. Let's take a look at the numbers. We're over 1.2 kilowatt hours right there. That's awesome. We're almost done. As far as this is concerned, we've almost hit the 100 amp hours, but we still have room left in the cells. So I'm really excited to see what this actually turns out to be. I hope the BMS doesn't shut down when the BMS thinks it's at zero. I hope it just keeps going. I'm not sure yet if it's going to stop. I haven't programmed it. I haven't configured it to anything. It's just making an assumption that it's a 100 amp hour battery. We are almost done. The beeping just started on the inverter. So the inverter is telling us that we're at low voltage. We are at 10.67 volts. One of the interesting things is how the voltage just drops off a cliff after 3 volts per cell. There's really not much power in a lithium iron phosphate cell below 3 volts. The cutoff is 2.5 volts per cell. So we're gonna go until the inverter shuts off or we hit 2.5 volts per cell, which would be 10 volts. All right, it just shut itself off at 10.3 volts. Let's take a look. Now our cells are gonna bounce back a little bit here. They were a little bit lower. But we got 1,478 watt hours. 1,478 watt hours. Oh, that's just incredible. These cells from battery hookup are listed as 5,000 milliamp hour cells, but I got an extra 15% more than what I should have gotten out of these things, which is just incredible. I love it when a company is able to over deliver. I mean, that's really fantastic. I love having a circuit breaker built into the battery. And temperature. Let's check what the temperature is.
we got up to 27.3 degrees Celsius, 33.2 pounds. A friend of mine has a vinyl cutting machine, so I'm gonna put a logo on here, and this will be my 12 volt battery. Here we go. Here we go. There we go. Awesome. I am proud to put my name on this battery. I like having the circuit breaker built in. It's in a clean package. Nice. Thank you everybody very much for watching. If you enjoy the videos, please like and subscribe to the channel. In the description below is going to be a parts list, and please leave a comment below if you can think of a better way to do this or something that I should include in a future video. Thank you very much.